class music. But let's start with a different kind of music here, maybe. Yesterday. All my, you remember? So far. Anybody was there? Now it looks as though they're here to stay. It's really okay if you don't remember also. That's perfectly right. Just wanted to start softly. Suddenly, come back to that mood. Now, so you remember the Beatles as well, right? That's important. Now, can you name this band? Maybe you can hear it. I know this is not the right generation to ask these questions, but any takers? It's not easy. And the reason it's not easy is because it's not a band. It's artificial intelligence that just scanned everything the Beatles did ever and just start writing songs like the Beatles. You've seen this before. We've seen Mozart, Bach, and so on. Now, that should open a little bit of the imagination that we need. And imagination is the first key for something that I call the mechanics of change, the change that you actually build. You cannot build anything you have not imagined. This is just the human neural network at work. And once we start imagining these things, we start to really ask very profound questions, right? And the biggest question out there is, what's the future? What is the future? <That's> the right. First mechanics of change, imagination, your imagination. Second mechanic, and this is a quick repetition from last year. I'll try to be as quick as possible to get there. You remember exponentiality. We talked about it last year. Things are moving exponentially faster. It's a flow of rapid, very profound Gutenberg moments, you know, every day. And we don't compute that. We think linearly. 30 steps ahead will be 30 meters ahead. What will be 30 double steps each time? So exponential steps, right? Who can complete this sequence very quickly? He's nodding, actually. Yeah, I guess there are some mathematicians in the room. It's 1 billion meters away. That's the actual speed of change. And now compare to the yesterday's 30 steps ahead. This is how your competition maybe thinks. This is maybe how we look at the world. So second mechanics of change, it's exponentially faster every time you look, and you don't compute that. You need to sit down and do the math. This is why we do have innovation centers. This is why we actually go to work. And the third mechanics of change, very quickly, is that it's unexpected. It converges in ways we couldn't imagine. I know that many of you play with Barbie. Maybe even this toy, the latest release a couple of years ago, Hello Barbie, and this is what Barbie can do for us.
I want to be a scientist.
Eureka, a scientist. I think science is so amazing. Why do you want to be a scientist?
I always really liked chemistry and physics in school.
The study of physics is incredible.
Yes.
Take gravity. You can't see it, but the second you trip, it's right there to pull you down. Did you ever fall or trip on something?
Yeah, unfortunately, all the time.
All the time.
It happens to me all the time.
All the time.
That's grab.
Anyway. This. Yeah. Yeah. They will also discuss spaces or tabs and other worldly topics. Now, this is very important because this product has more power than we could ever imagine 10, 15, 20 years ago. If I told you that someone will interview Barbie in a renowned magazine, you would think I'm crazy. Okay, let's move on from that. Let's move on from that person as well. Now, an example of that that is right in front of our noses, and we maybe don't think like that. This exponentiality and convergence. These guys are going to space, that's obvious. And then if you look around why they do it, we have Joel Solcell here. He's building that thing. He will capture asteroids, that's Joel, and he will squeeze out rocket fuel from asteroids because he wants to build gas stations in space. I met him. He's serious. And this is not cheap. that rock there, pictured by NASA, is worth 8,000 quadrillion pounds. It's, you know, it's Harry Potter. It's, it just doesn't exist. But that business is out there. Japan is developing extraterrestrial construction machines, and so on and so on. New Audi Quattro driving on the moon, 3D printed between Audi, SpaceX, and some scientists from Berlin, where I live. This is an ecosystem. And we have even manufacturing in space now because, you know, a kilogram of goods, shipping it up, it's extremely expensive, so they 3D print. And a cool name for a startup, by the way, Made in Space. I love it. What we just did is that we articulated a future. Let's go back and articulate it again. Yeah, there we go. Industrialization of space. You need to put it down. So imagine it, you describe it, then you build it. That's the sequence. That's the mechanics of change. Another change that we're seeing, I mean, doctors are really expensive and time-consuming to make, right? It takes 7 to 10 years to make a doctor. We love them, and we don't have them enough. But the thing is, every illness and condition you ever had, all the conditions in, you know, in the history of Homo sapiens, available at any time for everyone, for free, compared to all the research and all the conditions you have in every second and the next second. That doesn't scale on the human building blocks. We need something else. We need you. We need us to build that, because it's necessary. And we're seeing the first evidence. I'm going back to the dream and what's actually happening and pointing in this 30th exponential step direction, right? AI can predict if you will die by, you know, scanning your organs. Not sure what's the percentage is there, but it's quite good. We have the first artificial intelligence, if you wish, that passed a medical exam as a doctor, in a sense, in China. Also in China, we have the first robot that actually operates on your teeth. Would you like that? But it's happening, you know? And we're coming to this trust issue and all that, which is wonderful, because that's a very human discussion. And again, if you look in the sensor business, it's amazing. I guess nobody wore these sensors yesterday, because the chip on the tooth can also sense alcohol levels, which is pretty convenient if you're going home from the party yesterday. Can detect cancer, heart arrhythmia, and so on the fly. Just imagine the ecosystem again of usage. And talking about exponentiality, have you seen this device, anyone? Do you own it, maybe? Because then I want to meet you. It's a very cool thing. So it took billions of dollars, UN, and several countries to come together in the 90s to decode the human genome, the Holy Grail. What are we made of? And we did. It took 14 years or 15. And, you know, it was a big project. And that, as many of you already guessed, is a DNA sequencer. You can connect it to your laptop via USB and drop a little bit of blood, and it sequences your DNA. $1,000. Billions of dollars, $1,000. It's liberated for us to experiment on. And the prediction is, you know, it will be cheaper to sequence that DNA than flush your toilet in 2022. So you will have your DNA sequence included in your, you know, whatever you're buying there. And you must think of it as pretty revolutionary in that sense. You know the compass you have on your iPhone? It revolutionized how we discovered the world, the distribution of power and all that, yeah? This is the same thing. It will be in the hands of kids, researchers, students, everyone. And they will, you know, learn all these new languages to code and discover and program. I guess you heard about CRISPR-Cas9. We can today basically paste and match DNA for very cheap money compared to doing it very expensively in laboratory. Only experts can do it. No, it's getting liberated. Here, in my hand, and by the way, that might be a new programming language as well. We can make up DNA. Maybe imagine sets of DNAs converging in big, big ecosystems. What I'm holding in my hand there is a piece of human tissue. What's interesting is that it has been 3D printed by these guys that won that competition that I was judging, a startup from Berlin, that is 3D printing organs. And they didn't imagine, you know, software as a service. They said, it's an organ as a service. I was like, okay, that's a cool tagline. But you mean it? Yes. We can print, 3D print human tissue. It's not that you can put it in your body and it functions like a liver yet, but you can experiment on it. All of a sudden, the whole, you know, high school environment can go and experiment and break it because it doesn't cost so much. What would that mean for research, knowledge, transparency, and power? I think everything. And unlikely players are coming into that. We're talking about health insurance in U.S. specifically. It's totally screwed up. I lived in Sweden. It's not screwed up. And here is okay as well. What will happen if your Tesla, because it, you put your body in the Tesla, right? Your Under Armour, which is this company, or your Women's Health magazine, and we can move on, Allianz, and all these guys come together and build a new business ecosystem. And they collect this data, anonymize it in a way, it can serve it back to you to stay healthy, to be good. So Under Armour sells t-shirts, right? They also connect 38 million people around well-being. They are the biggest network, digital health network in the world. It's not your average insurance company, it's them. And I love that change, it's a good challenge. And maybe, you know, we will see that Barbie, with all the given technology in there, will be mentoring, analyzing, and medicating you in the future. And reflecting you beyond your bias. Yes, you should have another beer. Will never happen. Okay, Barbie. And the last one that I showed last year, but I still love it because it's interesting. We will not develop our brains very fast, but we will connect them. We will calculate the 30th exponential logarithmic step without effort because it will be on internet, on the webs. A guy I met the other year, Newton Howard, he was showing in his hand there, and we were pretty excited. This is me taking the photo. The gray piece of that, let me see if I have a blow-up of that. Yeah, the gray piece goes into your brain. And he told me like this, because he's already convinced. Martin, I will put this in your brain. I said, really? Yes, don't be afraid. I will put this in your brain. It's a procedure, it takes 2 hours. And then the white thing goes on your skull, because I need to communicate with your brain. And obviously, yeah. And he was already almost operating on me in his mind. And I will get data from your brain. Yes? And this is good. Does SAP want the data, by the way? I said, dude, I don't know. I haven't thought about it. What would you do? We can figure out how you think. We can maybe see your dreams, whatever. But he said, what I'm most interested in is to put data in the brain. Okay, Newton, let's chill. Let's just have a coffee and talk about this. Because, you know, people, yeah. That thing there, it's the smallest thing I found that is a sensor that maybe can put data there, not only get data. By the way, you work with data, you should be interested in this. It's basically like a grain of rice, you can swallow it. Imagine 30 exponential steps later, it can be vapor, that small. I don't know if you remember that guy, Serge Gainsbourg, yeah? French singer, playboy, and all that, cool type. He's smoking, obviously, as everybody did. Imagine smoking the language of French. Yeah? Because, yeah. And I can speak French, obviously, I should take another language. But because that's actually, in theory, imaginable. Now, the rest is actually hard freaking work and engineering. So yeah, science fiction is becoming science fact. And between that is you, hard work, and science. You know, the utopias, the imaginary fantastic worlds, are only a dootopia away. The utopia. The design, the discuss, the develop of the utopia. This is what happens. So if anybody tells you the bullshit that everything will go to hell because, I don't know, pick up any newspapers, I don't read news anymore. They haven't thought that we are in this room and we are about to design that future. And we think it should be good. And speaking of future, just spending 30 seconds on this imaginable futures. 30 years in 30 seconds, right? What could happen? India is the most populous country in the world. Artificial blood from stem cells. Maybe we run all our IDs on blockchain so globalization and work can happen seamlessly. Maybe we run all the missions to Mars automatically so we can focus on something else. And nanotech enables users to interact with other people by thought. Of course. And we have prototypes today that do that through electricity. So we need to imagine it is exponentially faster than you think and will converge in ways you didn't expect. So what have you imagined? What do you want the future to be? That's the question. The question is actually not what's the future. It's what do you want it to be? And this is a fact that sort of concludes everything. The now is just temporary. It will move very, very fast forward, and we will move it to a place where we want to be. That's our job. This is why we're here. And then people ask me, so what will people work with in the future? And again, this is artificial intelligence making successful musicals in London, because they scanned every success on Broadway, and they said, okay, I'll copy-paste. So they brought a new, never existing before piece and made a success, sold tickets. This is a friend from Berlin, Roman Lipsky. He paints to an AI, and then AI paints back to him. And he gets inspired and paints back to the AI. So they're playing ping pong. They're an art couple. The AI is obviously coded by engineers like you, three of them, that keeps it alive and keeps it interesting for Roman. And they exhibit, and it's getting attention. So if we're infringing even the human creativity in a way, I would say creation, because you need a Roman to create something like him. You need the Beatles. But at least it's a creation. Before the machines feel a sense of curiosity and purpose, this will be the fact. But the question remains, what will then be our jobs? And the same question is asked over and over again. You know, farmers 100 years ago, roughly, they were, you know, doing their job. They were 80% of the, or 90% of the population. We were farming, fishing, forestry, and all that. Now they're only 2%. If you ask the farmer back then, and now compare ourselves to our current pace of development, and people ask you, but Martin, robots will take our jobs. There will be no more jobs for humans. What can we imagine would be the jobs? Imagine being that farmer and, you know, start to answer these questions eloquently, you know? Yeah? Never happened. Sorry. Yeah, or this pickup line, this social interaction. Yeah? I don't think it happened. It never did. I don't know why. I maybe spent too much time on Google. or this one. Yeah, this is boring, but, you know, we can do this better. You know, it's like a self-driven and enabled career changer. This is a good guy. Never happened. Or this family discussion, you know? How are we going to raise our children? What should they do? You become an engineer, Martin. Never happened. Because they didn't know. It's hard to imagine. We don't know what we don't know. You know, the quadrants. We know what we know. We know what we don't know. But there is one. We don't know what we don't know. This is why we curiously seek forward. We develop. We love our life and being human. It's the human condition to discover. But yes, the question is still there. I love the faces here. Really? You the teacher? What the hell will you tell me? It's like me standing in front of you. I'm not even a developer, you know. It's a discussion, and I would expect this from you too. But I think they have the right attitude, the kids there. And observe, they are from Asia. And they are women. This is also a change we foresee. This is a very important, well-chosen picture by me. And the answer to that question, what will we teach them, is that we honestly have no freaking idea. And that's a good answer. It's a great answer, because now we can go to work. We have the utopia. What is the dutopia? The opposite of stability is not instability. So the opposite of not knowing, right? It is emergence. It is evolution. We create as we go. We remix. Life is a remix. We build on the shoulders of giants. And to do that, we have a little bit of new values. And, you know, I have not always been a futurist and a chief designer and all that grown-up stuff. I've done other things in my life that actually have exactly the same values. When I was 14, I started to play in a punk rock band. And then I had a 20-year-long music career. And we always ask these questions. What can we disrupt now? Show me a grown-up and I will, you know, challenge them. Experimentation, fearlessness, new experiences, failures and quick learning, the unfinished, the unperfect, the move forward. All these things define rock and roll, right? But all these things also define innovation, especially in the startup community, right? This is exactly what's happening out there. I guess you're too young for this. Let's skip forward. And these new values are necessary. I think we need more rock and roll in business. We need more rock and roll in innovation, in development, in imagination. We need to move from stability to emergence. Vice had a super blog there when a dad argues with his son. Son, you need to become, you know, an engineer or a doctor, an advocate, even better, right? And the son goes, Dad, you remember that discussion 25 years ago? I just read this, you know. Biological workers will be unnecessary. That's you and me, by the way. And empathy and creativity will save our jobs. Empathy and creativity. I haven't seen that on my KPIs for a long time. The future of human work is imagination and creativity and strategy. So long-term strategies, not tactical KPI killing. Boom, 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 Excel spreadsheet. And even World Economic Forum says that very soon from now, this will be the 10 skills you and I will have to be relevant on the market. Complex problem solving, critical thinking, creativity, emotional intelligence, understanding each other, cognitive flexibility, maybe sort of a AQ, like adaptability quotient, right? Or EQ, emotional quotient. How can I understand your needs? How can I imagine your world to develop something that is relevant in there, so I can be relevant for you? How can we have a value exchange about that? That's the questions, wonderful human nature questions that machines cannot ask yet. And also from a business perspective, you know, profit controlling and privacy, we talked about it this morning, excellent show, by the way, excellent keynote. And I think it's moving towards this. You cannot make money unless you're relevant, unless you show a purpose that plays a role for me. If this piece of hardware or software is not relevant in my life, why should I pay for it? Networking, experimentation, fearless and mutual understanding, transparency. These things will turn into the third industrial revolution values and will bring them to tomorrow. So, you know, as we say, predictable outcomes, repeatable results, scalable efficiency. You know, these grown-up things that people say at work when they have meetings. They also give them great bonuses and salaries, right? If you scale efficiently, you probably get a good salary. You can make a career in the third industrial revolution. But if you are predictable, repeatable, and scalable, you sound to me like a computer system or a program. I can automate you. So what are you really? Why do you exist? Curious purpose-seeking, experimentation, and mutual empowerment in networks and transparency. And, you know, these things are important. There's a list of the most empathic companies on the planet. It's an old one because Facebook is on top. So I need to look up the new one. But basically, good empathy is good business. This is what I'm saying. You make money if you understand your customers and your peers, your colleagues. You perform better. You have more fun and all that. And we happen to be on that list, and it makes us very innovative company. The reason I'm showing this, that we actually entered the list on number 42. Okay, good. Some of you get it. I love that number. It explains everything. Yeah. And yeah, my boss also got it. He said, oh man, let's stay there. Okay, a little bit of how we work with, how I look at the future. when I meet folks out there that want to transform, you know, digital transformation, Martin, can you talk about it? Yes, I can. But the thing is, when I do, you always say, yeah, so what can we do? What can you show me now that we can produce? So wait, I know that you're thriving really, really well. You scale efficiently and all that in this first horizon of innovation. It's called incremental continuous innovation. Sometimes it's actually backlog. It's not innovation. Just because you've never done it before, it doesn't mean that it's new. This is an important one. Nevertheless, it's not the only one, but most people live only there. They don't think exponentially. They don't imagine. They don't see the convergence. They haven't had a thought what would be next. What would they decide to be next? And look at the timeline here. If this is your first horizon, if the second comes in, it's exponentially faster, maybe. It's the horizon of trust, the adjacent innovation. What do you do that doesn't go to market already today? What have you planned there? How can you trust what in your abilities to move forward? It's a trust horizon. And you need to co-innovate. It must be open. It must be diverse. The discussion to create solutions and stuff in there. But wait, there's a third horizon, and the timeline is screwed up again. What is your vision? What would you like the future to be? Right? Have you written it down? And the cool thing, the normal business activity is forecasting. You have your resources, you know, you have your developers, designers, and business people, you know what they do, you have your money. Let's forecast how we will do 3-7 quarters from now. Forecasting. But that can only be done from first, maybe to the second horizon. Usually people don't have the second horizon, so just forecast for the next 3 quarters. What do you do with your imagination when you feel inspired? I want that to happen. Is that you backcast? It's an exercise where you put and articulate the future. Industrialization of space is happening. Energy is for free, right? What do we, if that's the 10th step, what would be the 9th, 8th, 7th, and 6th? How would you do the dootopia, your engineering, to get to the 10th without the cage of the first horizon, without being trapped in the current, the now, because it's only temporary, as I said before. So this is the one slider of how at least we work, and it's proven pretty successful. I can talk about it for hours, because this is actually my every Monday morning. How do we connect the horizon so we trust the vision that our customers, our partners, and our developers, and everybody we connect with trust that we have imagined something that is well articulated? They can read it and understand it and fight it if it's wrong. How can we trust our resources and solutions so these arrows meet? If they don't, we correct them. That's the dootopia. Do shit that makes it right. The trust horizon is the one when everybody fails. And we ask these profound questions again and again and again. Because this question for me gives many other questions. What is actually human? What is our human condition now and in the future? And what is work? Is it me going to a place, getting a salary, going home? And if the future is superhuman, how do we place these two there, right? And we can have a vision about work. We're working with these four dimensions. And just sharing it to you to get a conversation starting. Not all of this is nearly possible yet. But we think that, you know, building on our vision, which is improving people's lives. Observe, there's no code mention or software there. It's people. We also think there will be a symbiosis, an empathic symbiosis between machine intelligence and human ingenuity. And there we'll go to the sort of two sides of the story. In that symbiosis, in this X, in this crossroads, that important meeting point. Where the first one, imagine that your company, your enterprise, or your adventure, or whatever, is self-running. Imagine that it communicates with others and the ecosystem seamlessly, so you can focus on other things. For example, developing yourself beyond your bias and beyond your current capabilities, becoming sort of superhuman. So you can follow new purposes, new markets, new businesses, new ideas and visions, because you have more time for that. And maybe that's sort of an intelligent adventure. Maybe that redefines how intelligent meets in the future. Just some examples how that could work. I got this picture from a friend in Berlin, Alexander Mankowski. He's the futurist for Daimler. And he said, Martin, we need to look at this space as a human space. Look what these people are doing. They're sitting face to face and they discuss. Something we are really good at, especially with a cup of coffee or a glass of wine or something like that. We exchange subjective views and we normalize them and harmonize them. It's like putting data somewhere and then, you know, tag it, normalize it, harmonize it. And then if it's done, we can use it for something. So we move on to the next thing we don't know, haven't harmonized them. The car is doing all sorts of shit, you know, showing other people, other data, some insights, some support for that conversation. The conversation is now the key, because all the functions are automated to a certain degree, at least. And I think that's a way of looking at that human productivity. The human productivity, which is basically two things. Today we have a lot of repetitive tasks. The high-value human task, this discussion, discovery, challenging, emotional intelligence, it's not there. And we sort of have this development from before. We went from manual enterprises to transactional and now digital. For some of the folks out there, they actually see that they need to digitize. They need to understand that they are in the software business. And development is the key to everything. And we're moving into a new era that is the intelligent enterprise, or maybe even the self-running one. And look at the human values there. This is how we think it will happen. The software and the technology we're building is the evolutionary fuel. As I said, the brain will not develop, but the technology we build, actually you build because I still can't code, will make us better humans. I truly believe that. So, exploration and interactions, cognitive tasks, knowledge work, knowledge exchange, maybe even opinion exchange will become on a different level when we have facts to build on in each biased situation. And I always, when we did this piece, it took some time, I always thinking about the Maslow's pyramids of needs, you know? When you had the routine problem solving, okay, the roof is leaking, actually we don't have a roof, I'm hungry. I have no friends. I need love. You know, all these things, when they are solved, eventually you're thinking, I might be the next Picasso. Let's talk to someone. Martin, you're crazy. That's probably right. And all of a sudden, we have a human interaction, something that I can check, experiment, and fearlessly ask a safe space to develop and innovate. Yes. So we're moving from this. These things start to blur, the manual, the cognitive, with the emotional, the human condition, smoking French. And, you know, but just to bring it back to today, this is known cases for you, I know that. Automated stores. Australia wants systems that recognize your face so you can just board a freaking plane without showing this passport here and there. And, you know, everybody is suspicious about you. Brand recognition, we did a cool thing. We established our machine vision platform, and someone said, can we spot logotypes? Yeah, sure. So even in fast sports like sailing or hockey, yeah, sure. I mean, in a superhuman speed. Because we discovered that students were clicking, watching hockey games, like Volvo, Volvo, Audi, Audi, and they get paid to, you know, getting the brand impact because someone wants a commercial out. I said, wait a second, that's not human work. Seriously, guys. A student should read a book or drink beer or do something much more human. So we created it. And the thing is, once you've made that, you just not only change what work is, you change the whole business model. Now you actually get paid for your brand. Maybe now you can bet. If the hockey team is losing on this side, move your logotypes there. How much would you pay to move it? Now or now or now? Maybe you have algorithms even controlling the betting. That's a new business model. Anyway, that was the first dimension. Let's move quickly to the second one, self-organizing business ecosystems. I think it's about power in the end. And I think part of that power was touched upon again in the excellent keynote this morning. Someone said that currency, this is the current power, the more you have, it can be currency, oil, potatoes, I don't know, whatever. The more you have, because the business model of today is, I have, you don't, I sell. Yeah, that is the general history of the world. But I think it's moving to something else that is more like a current. The more I can distribute relevantly, and make people make shit up so they are happy, the more powerful or irrelevant you are. And, you know, we have big customers. So I was thinking about a brand like Chiquita, right? If I would call them and say, guys, I need 3 bananas. Again, someone would tell me, Martin, you're crazy. Chiquita doesn't ship bananas by 3. We maybe can sell you, 30 containers. This is what we do. If you want 3 bananas in your New York office by Tuesday, 2 p.m., and you want them a little bit green, that's going to be €69,000. Because this is the ecosystem you need to build to actually deliver that from Chiquita. Why? That's bullshit. How can we make this self-organizing so all these overhead costs are actually somewhere else? And we think we will build these self-organizing world ledger systems beyond company boundaries, which is basically illegal today. They are high-performing and go down to slot of 1.
Launch an international disaster relief mission just after an island has been struck by an earthquake. The United States, France, and the Red Cross set up camps all over the island. Each of them brings specific resources and know-how. The Red Cross helps with drinking water. France brings medical support, and the United States provides helicopters. The blockchain acts as a single source of truth and provides transparency over asset needs. Let's assume the French camp has several doctors that need to fly to the other side of the island. They enter a request in the app, which is then broadcasted to all mission participants via blockchain. All other participants can instantly see the request and react with a specific offer. Here, the United States can provide 3 helicopters to be on site in 30 minutes. All parties have agreed on a smart contract.
Okay, don't have to explain blockchain to you, but see the ability of, Red Cross, if you talk to them, they spend like 20 to 40% of their time communicating and bureaucracy and politics. And, they are really good in one thing, helping humans. And they really want to do that? They like it? Let them. Let them self-organize. I talked to a friend from, Singularity Net, the AI network? It's a cool thing. Anyway, he said, okay, if you connect the different AI functions out there and make a network of that, when they can communicate with each other, you can provide very different services back, self-organizing. It doesn't have to be on blockchain in that sense. But, if you get the payment processing AI from US somewhere, because the guys developed it, for complex financial transaction data sets, and you're using it to identify your possible, upgrade possibilities in your system, and then get another AI from China that is matchmaking you guys to actually build and implement that upgrade that has been identified, and then test it with the former AI, and then pay everybody accordingly to the success without touching a bit because you're busy with other things, actually developing the next thing, that would be a cool thing. So another self-organization. Okay, I won't spend much more time on that, but we were looking at the big and the small. We're getting data from the European space station, from European Space Agency, from a space station, to look how winds move, how traffic moves. And then we collaborate with Hyperloop and see how this traffic, the packages, down to one single package, delivery of this thing to my home or the 3 bananas, to big trains and the whole shipyards, and how that goes underground. Why do we need humans to administrate, to make the logistics controlling and sourcing and all that? It's really third industrial revolution jobs. We need to move on. So that was the second dimension. Now, let's move to the last side, which is the human side. The augmented me, the superhuman. The real deal. We've never been human yet, but we will be. And I think the software will help us. I think we make a journey that is unique through our working day, but also through our lives. And why is it not software responsive to that? You can imagine all sorts of help, reflection, and nudges in your life. And we just played around it. I just want to play around it with you here with sort of a co-pilot that tries to help me through my day. So I say, hey, co-pilot, what's up this morning?
Good morning, Martin. You will have a fairly busy morning, but there is time for a good cup of coffee. Okay. Your biometrics show me that it would be good for you. But just one cup, remember.
I remember. This guy probably knows that we had a party yesterday, because I'm wearing all sorts of shit. We will wear 15 to 25 different devices just in the next decade on our bodies. This guy also knows that I'm useless in the mornings. So you would have a very different message from the same guy. He would tell you that, hey, your morning will not be busy at all because you're really effective in the mornings. And your biometrics shows that you're up to speed. I want that companion, right? So, okay, Copilot, I've been talking to Leah, and she told me that we need to look in our team's performance and how they feel about the work, so job satisfaction, so all that. Can you talk about it?
Let me have a look. Your employee satisfaction numbers are quite good compared to the rest of the company and in the top 10% of the market you play in.
Okay, this is an ambiguous question. This is very hard to figure out. The thing knows my voice, knows my accountability in the system, knows my employees and how I interact with them from the history and from my behavior. So it guesses pretty well what I would like to hear and look into vertically here. So I say, okay, this was pretty cool, so continue.
Cross-functional projects build stronger product quality in your department. The more your developers travel together with your designers, the better employee satisfaction KPIs you get. Okay. There is a relation to higher performance year on year. Wow. It seems to be beneficial for your team performance to explore new ideas, especially for the least traveled colleagues. The boost in performance would be around 11%.
You know, I never seen this causality before.
You never asked. I will remember that you like this.
So, a little bit of supervised machine learning here, sort of. This thing, to find these causalities, not correlations, would, I don't know how many Excel spreadsheets I would have to go through. Maybe this is actually not possible for human. I think this is superhuman. And also to find that, you know, if you, specifically these functions, developers and designers, if they travel together face to face, they perform better. Wow, how many years of statistical analysis would we have to do? All right, thank you, but I'm a little bit worried about this travel cost and all that. Is there anything we can do there?
When colleagues travel so they can spend time face to face, your delivery quality goes up 5%. That saves software maintenance costs with customers by 2.5%. I found the routes that would make sense economically and that allow the colleagues to spend the most time face to face. We will review them tomorrow.
Okay, so now I'm working for the robot. We will review them tomorrow. You know, but that's okay. I'm just happy for these insights. And I'm traveling tomorrow as well, so, you know, is everything set up?
Yes. Oh, here is a surprise. If you switch from window to an aisle seat on tomorrow's flight, you will most likely be more successful in your budget negotiation, according to your travel and performance data. Wanna change?
Yeah, hell yeah. If I get more budgets just by switching a seat in on the plane, because I'm more awake if I am closer to the sun or whatever. If you find this out, I mean, really?
Yes, really. Martin, I am not just a pretty face.
Okay. and, you know, we've seen the beginning of this. I know this is science fiction. This is really hard to make. The architecture for these causalities and that kind of provisioning and that kind of individual software. We're talking about, it's not there, but I see guys doing really awesome stuff already. When I say individual software, why do we code applications? Why do they not emerge in front of me while I walk through my day, changing functions every 5 minutes, checking the emails, checking my budgets, talking to my team? Why don't we have emergent applications with minute services bringing everything that might be relevant right now with this kind of personal connection and relationships? This is the individual journey we're talking about, right? This is the superhumanity we're looking for. Because, you know, the smartest app in the world is the one that makes you smarter. That's the smart app. This is what we're developing. This is what we want. And it's sort of building this relationship. I mean, data is important. It's sort of the content, the information, but it must become knowledge and sort of a wisdom. Or features or products, and you need to serve them and build relationships. Because the tasks we build upon there is not collecting features and data. Everything below that line can be automated or should be hidden from human ingenuity. So we can focus on nurture relationships and wisdom to find new markets, to build new stuff. And lastly, then we can pursue, you know, the big thing, the next new thing. Imagine new worlds, imagine new markets, new relationships. And we already see that people will not take a job unless they see relevance of you, us, on the market. Someone made this funny karma American Express bank statement telling you, okay, you've been a good human. You tagged some data. You downloaded songs legally. Hey, here's your account of, you know, doing good. I like that imagination. Or take a current example, and I wish we could help them with quantifying and qualifying their purpose in the system. How much is this worth for your business? Because they're saying, you know, the president stole our land, so they sue Donald Trump for taking land from nature reserves. They're making jackets, guys. And they say, we repair your jacket. And you go, yeah, everybody should. It's like a lifetime warranty. And they go, no, because it's a radical act. These jackets are good. You don't need a new one. And so on. So basically, they do this. They are making jackets, but they love the planet. They want you to love the planet as well, so they make a jacket so you can go and discover it, because it's a harsh place out there. And when you have the jacket and you see the planet, you go, man, this is beautiful. They go, told you so. You want to save it? Yeah. That's the ecosystem. Because they are in the business of saving the planet. They happen to make jackets. We are in the business of improving people's lives and running the world. We just happen to make software. What business are you in? Why are you relevant in 10 years from now? Why are you loved, needed, and respected, and provide something that people actually would like? That's the question. And that can be any kind of software, product, service, whatever. It can be, what are your dreams? What do you pioneer and explore? It doesn't have to be save the planet. It can be a function. So, concluding on that, it's sort of a human adventure. It's not just an intelligent enterprise, because that sounds very sort of our domain, but it's a human adventure that we all walk on. And we have the harmony, the rails, the something that gives us the certainty where we're going, the reflection of the reality, the facts. And here we have the human tension. Because humans always screw things up. We love that, you know? When everything is normalized, we just make art that we even don't understand. We are curious and we seek and we ask questions. And I think it's time to talk about this human-machine intelligence, human-machine learning, when we augment the machines with human intelligence. And maybe we can redefine what work is. That is actually to surface, foster, and optimize the gifts. HR call it skill sets, yeah? But I think it's gift, something you can give to an idea. I can code that. I've done that before. Consider it a gift. Of course, you need a salary as well. But that we are about to solve. And I loved Richard Branson's, there is a reason why we are called human beings and not human doings. Don't forget the to-do list, but remember to write a to-be list. And just lastly, it's sort of an activism, what you're doing, guys. You're liberating tools. You're democratizing the ideas to be released. You're democratizing the tools for the dootopia. Because, you know, let's make a Earth history in three things. Process ownership. Hear it, what it does, do it, and I pay you. That was the sort of a first step, right? And then we said, hey, education is on the rise. Everybody's getting more aware. They become experts. So basically, you could say, what you can do if you are me or pay me. But this is where we're entering. We're in the era of emergent creativity. You build something. You open it, and you say, I just can't wait what you will do with it. Go, break things, and come back, and have a human discussion. And I won't even ask you who wrote this music, because you already know. It's an artificial intelligence called Iva. And the piece is called Genesis. It's nice, no? The thing is, Genesis, it's sort of always a new beginning. We are all, the now is so temporary. You are creating new beginnings every time you're being relevant for someone. With your engineering, with your human ingenuity, connecting to the machine intelligence. You are the dootopians to create the utopia. And, you know, when we come together and actually do cool shit, we actually can design a future we really all want to live in. And I'm pretty positive that we are doing it today. And as last time, without having an idea why, but I love this piece. I want to end with a poem. You're a ghost driving a meat-coated skeleton made from stardust, riding a rock, hurtling through space. So fear nothing. Thank you very much. Thank you. Hi.
Excellent. So let's add to our to-be list to be on time. We're in lunch break, but I think this was so exciting. We do some Q&A if you want to. So we do another 5 minutes of questions. Yeah. If we got the information, if we can get them here on the screen from the Slido people. And whoever wants to get out, go silently out, have food before everybody else has. It's always a better idea to go after a lunch queue when everybody else is gone, when they bring the second part in, because it's normally the healthier food and the better food anyways. So we have some questions here, actually, for you. So will there be software developer? Will the software developer exist in 30 years?
So I cannot answer that question, because if you understand, nobody can predict the future. That's absolute bullshit. My question is, would you like software developers to exist within 30 years? Okay, maybe not. Yeah, hell yeah. The thing is this. Software is changing its sort of a nature. I just showed you the human DNA that we can paste and cut and put it wherever you want. We can today operate on bacteria, make them to conglomerate in a certain way through software. It's electrical impulses on a big scale. I don't know if you've seen that experiment. So basically, we can control the natural world with software. We have computational design in architecture, where we build the first steps to an idea with some parameters, and then the human ingenuity comes in. So what is software rather than the world and the cosmos? Of course there will be developers of our nature and our physical and intellectual space, and also the virtual space, absolutely. But the software language will be maybe the physics of our cosmos rather than lines of code.
They were in the past as well. I mean, coding changed over the years, more and more into abstracted levels. Yeah. We used bigger and bigger systems, and the assumption of making loops, of making conditions, of making finding out patterns in things, that's what coding became. So the DNA coding is, in essence, software as well.
Yes.
Nice. So how can we ensure that all this amazing technology that even experts can hardly wrap their head around does more good than bad for society? How can we stop the bad guys from doing the great things first?
Okay, haven't you been listening, guys? Maybe that was an early
Obviously
question
not.
When I was still on the Beatles. But it's a very relevant question. It seems to be like this. Whatever we imagine and put out there and articulate happens. It's just human history. I mean, some people says these people are better than these people, and it happens. Some other people say, we will go to the moon, and we're bringing the guy back, the same guy, and alive, and it happens. Anyway, by the way, 10 years, that's the deadline, sorry. And see, so when you articulate a wish, a utopian, and fantastic thing, we go for it. But we also fear a lot, you know, the amygdala thing happening. We love fear. This is what the newspapers thrive off. News are a product, like Coca-Cola. Don't consume it, it's not good for you. Read papers, study facts, understand experts, exchange opinions on what is actually there. It's called peer review, and so on. This is where you build a future you want to live in, not something that a future that people hand to you. Oh, this will happen to me, the robot will take your job. Not yours, but you, man. We need to talk about this. I just charged $7.99 per second. See, this is what they thrive off when they say, how can bad things not happen? Because we decide so. You code the future. Do you want it to be bad? No. So this is why I believe in humans. That's it. And the human ingenuity and the expression of the, you know, radical optimism. I watch a lot of science fiction, and I hope you also do, because it's inspiring. Some of the things there are actually being engineered on. I still wish for the science fiction where robots don't eat us alive. You know? Mm.
I talked in my keynote about this, and I'm a strong believer of that, that the Star Trek world of Gene Roddenberry, where like we're past money, we're past hierarchy, I want to have that world. And I think our technology has overtaken us, and society hasn't quite. If anything, right now, it seems like we're reverting to the 1920s, where everybody was super paranoid and some fascist government then took over. And I don't want this world. But how do we do this? It seems like there in politics there's right now a concentrated attack on intellectualism and on positive futurism. How can we counteract this?
Yeah, I think first we maybe should understand the reason for that. And I think it's clear, you touched upon this. You remember this 30 exponential steps, like we have 10 Gutenberg moments per year. So big shifts that people have every third generation maybe back then, right? Now they are lined up and they become a flow. For us, it's a flow of inspiration, flow of opportunities. For many, it's a flow of fear. Because every change is like this edge. It's like mountain biking. You just want to do it, it's going to hurt, but it's going to be awesome. But some people just don't. It's a way of explaining how the mechanics of change work to the people that fear it. Hey, this is happening. You're standing before an edge every day. This is why you're fearful all the time. I want to go back. By the way, impossible, Einstein and all that. So let's not turn anything but great again because you can't. So explain how the mechanics work, why you're fearful. Maybe then people step back. What would you like to happen instead of fearing it? If you fear, privacy will be taken away from me. Define privacy first. And then what would happen if it would be taken away from you? What would you like to happen instead? The utopian. Then we do the dootopia. We are engineers. We are developers. We do this. So that would be, and educate yourself. And it's possible. I mean, you can read up on quantum mechanics on YouTube in a half year. You couldn't 15 years ago. Just impossible. It was the experts, you remember? Now, we just can't wait what you will do with it. Do something positive. But that discussion must be there with the politician. This is on the mechanics of change. Please be good. Imagine something positive.
Well, it brings us to the question here, what would the schools of tomorrow look like? Mm-hmm. And to a degree, Khan Academy questioned that a long time ago, where it said, like, teachers should not be there for the whole lesson, but only when the students get stuck and point them in the right direction. Mm-hmm. But how do you quantify that? How do you make that measurable for a school institution? Or is school as we know it nowadays not as necessary anymore?
As we know it nowadays, it's not necessary anymore. That you just black and white answer, obviously, it's a little bit more complex than that. I think the schools played out their role. I met with an entrepreneur in Bulgaria, and he said, so look, I made an exit, I made some money, I don't care. So I started 3 new companies, and we're doing it. It's fun. I'm employing hundreds of people. But the only thing I get is mathematicians. Because in Bulgaria, from the Soviet era, everybody is a mathematician. It's a culture of mathematics. But the application of that, they're useless, you know, they can't program. They cannot solve problems that are applicable in the real world. So we need to educate them ourselves, and our universities don't do that. So he did this. I've got money, wait a second. I start a school. Maybe I start 10. Maybe I will make them not my schools for my company. I make them just schools, just put my name on it, and I just take the best 10% of the pupils there and employ them, and the rest is open for the competition and the rest of Bulgaria. Because when the competition grows, I grow my ecosystem of customers as well. Awesome. So he just circumvented the whole idea of academia and made his old school just to benefit. So it's happening already. And we need that same discussion with the institutions, that they're solid, you know, not changing, not adaptable to change, as we do need with politicians.
Well, kind of the same works with companies. I mean, we released open source courses that you can work with, and we release open source software for people to develop things with, so when they start in a company, they can hit the ground running because they already know the systems that they're going to use.
Yeah.
And that's education that they can take to the competition, that's fine as well. As long as they follow best practices, everybody will be better. So when Wikipedia came out, basically it was impossible to do Wikipedia as a commercial product. Nobody would have paid for that. Nobody could have amassed that amount of data in that short amount of time. But that was like 20 years ago almost when that started, and it kind of gradually fell into disarray. Mm-hmm. So do you think the fast movement that we have nowadays with consumerism on mobile devices, that people are becoming less of a read-write web than just a consume web? Are we pushing the new media that we have into the channels of the old media, like TV and radio has been?
No, I cannot foresee that. But it's an interesting question from a perspective where So I saw some numbers. You know, millennials have been accused of being just assholes, and that's not really true, but, you know, they aren't bad employees and all that. But they grew up very quickly, by the way, so the generations were shorter as well, in their minds, the cultural generations. Grew up with having idols, the Kardashians and whatever, the YouTube generation. I want to be a YouTube star. How? I don't know, but that's going to happen to me someday. Now, the Generation Z, according to studies, is very different. They say this. If you ask them, who do you look up to? I don't know, but I'm quite good. I just learned this, by the way. I learned DJing or coding. Oh, but if it's not you, is there anybody else? Yeah, my peers, the other Generation Zs. Because the DJ thing, I learned from that girl. And she showed me, she's making 50 bucks a night. That's a lot. This is how they operate. So 60% say that they believe in themselves and their own pursuit of opportunities. Without schools, without authorities, if you wish, or institutionalized knowledge, or they read, this is what you give me to read, and I then risk. No. They choose what they want to know from their peers and their imagination. And another piece of fact, they actually go visit each other, so they get up and shake hands. How do you DJ? Show me. How did you build that website? I want to know. Do you make any money? Show me how. They discuss in ways that we didn't expect. Because you cannot be just me looking at things. It's always a we. It's not the IQ, it's the WeQ, as someone said. And you need to discover that we. And they started. So I'm very optimistic that it will continue. With the empowerment of the tools, by the way. If they can sequence their own DNA and have play around with the DNA, they will. Over, you know, a Friday night and a couple of beers. Let's see how that goes.
Excellent. That's a nice little positive outlook of the future, and I think it's a good place to end on. So let's take a look at each other having food and have conversations around it, and we see each other again after the lunch break. Thank you
Lovely.
So much.
Thank you very much. Hey, it's been awesome. Thank you very much.